Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Niklas Medinger, and it's both an honor and a pleasure for me to be opening this year's USENIX conference with this talk about our form analysis of the IEEE 802.11 WPA2 Wi-Fi standard and how we counted the cracks caused by cracking the counters. Of course, this work was not done by me alone. I am joined by my fellow co-authors Benjamin Kiesel and Kas Kremers. Alright now, let's dive into it. First of all, what is WPA2? WPA2 is the de facto standard protocol for secure communication over Wi-Fi. In fact, it is so widely used that if you are using your laptop right now to view this talk and you are connected to the internet via Wi-Fi, you are almost certainly using some kind of WPA2. To allow for this secure communication, WPA2 aims to set up shared cryptographic keys between the access point, for instance your home router, and the client, for instance the laptop you're using right now. One of those shared cryptographic keys is the so-called pairwise transient key. It is different for each client that is currently connected to the access point, and it is negotiated between the client and the access point over the WPA2 execution. The second important key is the so-called group transient key. As its name suggests, it is used for group messaging, and hence it is the same for each client that is currently connected to the access point. And over the course of the WPA2 execution between the client and the access point, it is only shared from the access point towards the client. So let's take a look at how WPA2 shares or sets up those keys. It does so via the so-called four-way handshake. The four-way handshake between the access point and the client starts off by having the access point generating the so-called anons, a number used only once. It'll then send message one towards the client, which contains these anons and a replay counter. As their name suggests, those replay counters are used in the four-way handshake to detect replays from the client towards the access point. The access point will increment this replay counter after usage, and the client will always answer with the last replay counter it saw. So, after the client received message 1, it'll generate its own contribution towards the randomness, the so-called S-nons, and it'll derive a candidate pairwise transient key from both the S and the anons. It'll then send message 2 towards the access point, which consists of the S-nons, the counter it saw in message 1, and the message authentication code computed with the just-derived candidate pairwise transient key. After the access point received message 2, it'll also derive this candidate pairwise transient key and use it to encrypt the currently in-use group key and its associated nonce. We will talk more about those nonces in a minute, don't worry. It'll then send those encrypted key and disencrypted nonce in message 3 together with an incremented replay counter and another MAC. After the client received message 3, it'll accept this candidate pairwise transient key as an in-use pairwise transient key, and it'll also accept the group key it just got from message 3. It'll confirm this towards the access point by sending message 4, which consists of a counter of the replay counter it saw in message 3 and another MAC. And after the access point saw message 4, it'll also successfully finish this four-way handshake and accept the pairwise transient key they derived. Okay, so what could go wrong here? WPA2 had actually been considered secure up until 2017, apart from certain offline guessing attacks. But in 2017, Vanhoof and Pissens broke the WPA2 protocol via their so-called crack attacks. Those crack attacks exploited message retransmissions in the four-way handshake to achieve reinstallation of the pairwise transient key. And this reinstallation then led to nonce reuse in WPA2's authenticated encryption schemes. Okay, now let's talk about those nonces for a second. Those nonces in the context of authenticated encryption schemes are equivalent to initialization vectors in the context of more traditional cryptographic schemes. They are used together with a key to encrypt data and are incremented after each encryption. But in those authenticated encryption schemes, the reuse of those nonces actually led to the key being leaked towards an attacker. And this also happened in the crack attacks. So let's now take a look at how such a crack attack looks like. The crack attack starts off by having the access point and the client executing a four-way handshake up until message 3. Then the client will accept the keys and will send message 4 towards the access point. However, this message 4 will never arrive at the access point as our man in the middle attacker will intercept the message. Now, from the point of view of the client, the four-way handshake has been successfully finished, and the client is more than happy to use the just derived and accepted pairwise transient key to encrypt data together with its nonce, which is initiated as 0. However, from the point of view of the access point, The four-way handshake never actually finished since it did not receive message 4. Hence, the access point is left to assume that message 3 was lost in transmission and it'll retransmit message 3. Now, once this retransmission of message 3 arrives at the client will also re-accept the pairwise transient key, in turn resetting the associated nonce, but not changing the pairwise transient key as it is still the same. Now, once the client sends more data encrypted with this pairwise transient key towards the client, the nonces will end up being reused and the attacker is able to learn the pairwise transient key. And hence, she can decrypt subsequent traffic. Okay, now that Van Hoof and Pistons broke the WPA2 protocol, they also wanted to fix it. They did so by proposing logical and intuitive countermeasures. After all, the problem is not difficult to fix, is it? We just want to avoid the reset of the nonce if we're reinstalling a key that was already in use. So then the IEEE implemented some version of this countermeasure. But however, in 2018, Van Hoof and Pistons found new crack attack variants. And some of those variants were even able to circumvent their own countermeasures they proposed a year earlier. So what happened here? Were the countermeasures Van Hoof and Pistons proposed ineffective, or did IEEE implement them poorly? No, none of that. What actually happened is that Van Hoof and Pistons found new, awesomely clever attacks which abused power-saving options of the WPA2 standard. Those power-saving options interacted with other mechanisms in WPA2, namely the handshakes, in ways that were not known prior. And hence, even Van Hoof and Pistons were not able to anticipate those attacks 1 year earlier. However, they then proposed new improved countermeasures, which again were logical and intuitive. But as we've seen, we cannot trust our intuition with the protocol as complex as WPA2, and hence we would like to have it formally verified. Okay, before we move on to our formal verification, let's talk about all the complex mechanisms at work in WPA2. At the core of WPA2, we have the four-way handshake. It serves as a way to negotiate the pairwise transient key, and it will initially inform the client of the current group key. However, should the authenticator decide to update this group key, it needs to inform each currently connected client. It does so by executing the group key handshake with each client. And as this group key handshake uses the pairwise transient key, it depends on the four-way handshake. Both handshakes use replay counter in each message, and hence both handshakes depends on replay counters being used correctly. However, both handshakes are also only a means to an end, as the keys they share or negotiate are used in data confidentiality protocols. Hence, those data confidentiality protocols used in WPA2 depend on both handshakes. Those protocols, however, also depend on the nonces that they use, as we've seen, that nonce reuse leads to the key being leaked. Now, in 2018, Van Hoof and Pistons discovered the two mechanisms, the so-called sleep bit and the so-called WM sleep node, actually interact with the other mechanisms. Both are power-saving options, which allow the client to temporarily opt out of pairwise messaging in case of the sleep bit, and group messaging in case of the WM sleep mode, and hence they both interact with their respective handshake. Okay, now this is where we can to formally verify the WPA2 model, we created a formal model of WPA2 with the Tamarin prover. To do so, we modeled the state machines that are specified in the WPA2 standard. The four-way handshake, the group key handshake, everything is defined in manner of state machines. In total, there are 7 of those state machines. To then capture the key leakage as a result of nonce reuse, we refined our Tamarin model with additional, more accurate rules to faithfully capture this and to have a more realistic model of cryptography. Overall, we estimated this took 12 perfect months of the work, and a lot of time of this work was actually spent on understanding and reading the WPA2 standard, as it's a 3K-page document. However, both Benjamin and I were novice Tamarin users and did not have any prior experience with WPA2. Hence, if you are trying to verify your protocol of which you have more knowledge, or if you are already experienced with Tamarin, your mileage may vary. Now, what did we actually end up proving? We proved the security of the pairwise transient keys and the group keys used in WPA2. And we also proved the authentication of the four-way handshake, meaning that a client is successfully authenticated against the access point after having executed the four-way handshake with it. This verification was not done automatic. we needed a lot of intermediate statements, so-called lemmas, to have the Tamarin prover prove those statements. And at times we even needed to prove the state some intermediate statements manually, as the Tamarin prover has a graphical user interface which allows for this. Our analysis improves on previous analysis, as previous analysis did not cover mechanisms such as the key leakage through nonce reuse and intricate mechanisms such as WN sleep node and the sleep bit. Hence, our analysis covers a large class of attacks that previous analysis did not cover, including the crack attack. And as a corollary to our results, we obtain that there are no crack attacks on the pairwise transient keys in the now twice patched WPA2 protocol. Alright, to conclude, this provides the first formal security argument for WPA2 that covers intricate mechanisms such as the WM sleep mode, the sleep bit, and the nonce reuse, leading to the key leakage. Now that WPA2 is formally verified, it joins the ranks of other highly complex and widely used formally verified protocols such as TLS and 5G. I hope I've sparked your interest in reading our paper and checking out our website, which is linked. Also, feel free to check out and build our model, which we've submitted to the USENIX artifact evaluation and successfully passed. Also, it is available on GitHub. With that, I would like to thank you for your attention.